This is it. You're listening to Jacob Dean.
Most of our leaders have either sold out, caved in, gave up. They don't want to tell people the truth.
If you're looking for filters, you came to the wrong place.
They're too concerned about their careers. They're too concerned about success. They're too concerned about just winning the next election for their status.
We bring you the real stuff. This is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean.
But who wants to tell the truth? The condition of truth is to allow suffering to speak. If you don't talk about poverty, you're not telling the truth. You're not talking about working people being pushed against the wall with corporate profits high. You're not telling the truth.
You're listening to Jacob.
If you're not talking about the criminal activity on Wall Street and not one person going to jail yet, you're not telling the truth.
Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean on the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, Radio or Not, and filterfreeradio.com.
And we live now in revolutionary times, but the counter-revolution is winning.
Live every Monday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern.
We're going to have a new wave of truth-telling. We're going to have a new wave of witness-bearing. And we're going to teach the younger generation that these brothers didn't struggle in vain, just like John Brown and Nat Turner and Marcus Garvey and Martin King and Miles Horton and the others did. And we shall see what happens. We might get crushed too. But you know what? Then you just go down swinging like Ella Fitzgerald, Muhammad Ali.
And welcome to Filter Free Radio, proudly broadcasting live from Portland, Oregon, and our nation's capital, Washington, D.C. Finally, a place where we can turn off the fantasy television that is dominating everything, and this ridiculous, broken electoral political reality show. It's not good, and it's time that we actually sit down and have a real conversation about the real issues, a serious discussion of the real issues that matter most. And I'm so happy that you've chosen and you've found a small pocket of the internet, a nonprofit, independent media voice for we the people. Welcome to Filter Free Radio. We are broadcasting live on our website, filterfreeradio.com, where you can participate in our live chat room. Also on the home of Nicole Sandler, radioornot.com, and progressiveblendradio.com. And also, we're archived for you, as always, online for free at YouTube. And so, however you may be joining us, thank you so much for checking us out. I am Jacob Dean, coming to you live from Portland. With me, as always, is our super-duper awesome mass producer, co-host, and all-around kick-ass awesome guy, Skeptical Scott.
Hello.
From Washington, D.C. What's up, buddy?
Hey, happy to be here doing my thing, trying to make it happen.
And always good to have you with us, man. And lots to get to. I showed a graphic really quick. I want to open the show with this. We have a brand new way for you to interact with this program. Whether you want to call in to a live show when we live broadcast, as we are doing right now, and you want to participate live on the air, when we take phone calls, you can call our comment line, or anytime 24/7 when we're not live, you can call and leave a unfiltered message for Filter Free Radio, myself or for Scott, and just keep in mind that those messages may be played on the air if we choose to do a caller comment bit segment. And this is the first time that we've ever announced this. We just hooked it up yesterday. I posted a couple of interesting announcements on the Facebook page, and I told a few folks about it. We already got one message, and so we're going to share that with you coming up in the next segment. But that number, and I'll put it up on the screen for you. We're not going to take your calls now. We'll take them in the second hour of this program. But the number is 202-6979-FFR. 202-6979-FFR. That's 337. There's the other graphic. Yeah. So when you see that on the air and you're watching the program, we'll take your calls live. And that's so cool. And you can, like I said, leave a voicemail for us 24/7 anytime by calling 202-6979-FFR. How about them apples, Scott? More interaction.
Yeah.
more interaction with our awesome folks out there. And that's so cool. And lots coming up in the program today. I want to talk about, of course, tonight is the third presidential debate between Obama and Romney. I want to talk about what happened at outside of the second presidential debate that not many people heard about, the fact that the Green Party presidential and vice presidential candidate wanted to enter the debate, and they were denied so. And thanks to good folks like Amy Goodman and Democracy Now!, we know about that. I want to talk a little bit about that. I want to talk about why we don't have candidates like George McGovern anymore. And I want to talk a little bit about that, and that relates to the Chris Hedges article and several other articles. I mean, John Nichols wrote an article about the late McGovern, who passed yesterday at the age of 90, Senator.
George McGovern.
And he won
the Democratic candidate for president in 1972 against Richard Nixon.
Thank you. And he was the presidential candidate, like you said, Scott, in 72. I want to play, we have a couple of clips that we I want to share with you from the Come Home America speech that he gave at that, was it at the convention?
I believe it was the Democratic National Convention in Miami in 1972 at 2 o'clock in the morning. You know, well, by the time he finally took the stage to give his acceptance speech of the Democratic nominee for president to run against Richard Nixon. And you know, this is it's really sad that someone of this I don't know, good nature and stature has passed. But it's also worth noting that you and I talked about, we really don't know who George McGovern is. I mean, how often do you hear his name mentioned or even discussed? And he's, you know, even in the last, let's say, of course he's 90, so let's say, you know, when he was in his 70s, which would have been in the 1990s, you know, he wasn't part of the Democratic establishment. Sure as hell didn't hear about him supporting Bill Clinton, or, you know what I mean? Like, he wasn't out stumping for the Clintons or any of that good stuff, you know, much less Obama. So you didn't really hear about him until he passed or became ill in the last few weeks or months. And so it's worth noting that, because it's the kind of person he is, as I've recently learned by his eulogies, is that he was a man of great integrity and great character, and someone who you do not see these days in public politics, or, you know, certainly, you know, on the stump, or, you know, on public television, or where have you, running for office. There's no one with his integrity, with his candor. I mean, the guy was just brutally honest. And, you know, one of the things it says here in his, I think that Chris Hedges wrote about him, was that, here's a politician who cared more for his country and human decency than he did for his political ambitions and his career.
There you go.
I believe he just saw politics as a way to do good. Which is worth noting, because it's something that we really take for granted is no longer the case.
Like, what the hell happened to that, right? So,
You know, who gets into public office to do good anymore? It seems so naked. nakedly self-serving. You know, it's no longer this way.
So. It's so funny, because I just had that conversation with my girlfriend like last night. We were talking about that, and I'm like, you know, there are a couple of local positions on the ballot. Where I am in Portland, Oregon, that don't even have candidates filed for. So it's a complete write-in position. And it's like, you know, time to really get active and involved, right? So I want to talk a little bit about that. Why don't we have any candidates, or at least someone out there talking like, for example, the late Senator George McGovern? We'll cover that in a little bit. Also, kind of interesting. This is, you know, kind of interesting. We have officially been censored or filtered or whatever, banned adjective you want to use or fill in there. Filter Free Radio has officially been filtered and censored, and I want to tell you about that and why it's ironic, I think, in my opinion. I'll explain that coming up in just a little bit. But first, oh, and by the way, of course, we will be giving away a super cool, awesome, handy-dandy filter-free radio bumper sticker, and I have, I was waiting, you know, I didn't really, well, I know how we're going to give it away, but it's a surprise, and we'll give it away before the end of the show, I promise. So, with that in mind, I'll mention the comment line again, which you can now call anytime, 24/7 to leave a message, 202-6979-FFR, which is 337. I should change the graphic there. I just realized that. So anyways, we're going to give away a bumper sticker coming up in the program. And the comment line is going to have something to do with that. Ooh. Oh, did I just give away a hint? All right. So let's get to the news, and lots in it. The one thing that I want to talk about, obviously, it is election season, right? We are a couple weeks away now from the presidential election, but, oh, see, I just did it myself. I wanted to say we're a couple of weeks away from the election. And you notice how it's so easy to slip in presidential election or to think about, when you think about the election, the first thing you think about is the presidential race. It is a special race. It is a significant race, and there's something special and different about the presidential race than any other race or ballot measure. That is absolutely true. But it is not the only matter on the ballot. The presidential election is only one item on your ballot. I am talking, I am registered to vote in the state of Oregon, which is where I'm living now, and is my home.
Go Ducks.
Yeah, go Ducks. Hey, man, go Beavers, too. Both Oregon and Oregon State undefeated and in the top, like, eight in the polls. I'm sorry. That's freaking awesome.
No one cares.
Anyways, I wanted to spend a couple minutes and say, hey, do you realize, of course, you know, the people who probably check out this program are like, oh, yeah, totally, dude, got it. But I'm speaking to the person who doesn't realize that, you know, oh, yeah, by the way, there's more to this election than just Obama and Romney or a third party candidate, Jill Stein for president. That's the button I'm wearing. There are many statewide, local positions, races. Up for grabs, representatives, state representatives, state senators, your U.S. senator, your U.S. representative. It's basically, you know, you have a national representative, you have a national senator, you also have a local statewide representative, a local statewide senator, and not to mention all the other local, statewide, and local ballot measures, propositions.
Ballot initiatives.
Ballot initiatives. Yay. Right? I should have pulled out that, what was that?
You know, it's worth noting that the only real reason I'm going to even bother voting, because quite frankly, the presidential election is, you know, it's more than I can stomach, is the down ticket, what they call the down ticket items. And that is obviously your ballot initiatives, your county, state, and municipal elections, as well as other, you know, like I'm looking at my sample ballot, and there's, I think, 8 or 9 county and municipal initiatives you have to vote for, like basic funding for roads and bridges and things like that.
Right.
Sort of things that are actually important and things that are more, I think, hands-on and affect you directly as an individual.
Right.
More so than I think even voting for any kind of candidate. So at the very least, you should be aware of and conscious of the initiatives that are on the ballot. I mean, for, you know, we're going to get into that too, right, Jacob?
Yeah, exactly. I want to go right to that because, and I don't want to spend too much time on this, but here's a question I want to propose to you. And again, we'll take your calls in the second hour on our brand new filter-free radio comment line. What is on your ballot that is making you vote besides the presidential election? Is it a local race? Is it a local measure? Is it a state measure? I'm curious. What's on your ballot? How are you voting, if you're willing to tell us, and why? Because I think why is the most important question. And that's why I want to spend a couple minutes and talk about what's going on here in the state of Oregon. I'm in Portland. I won't talk about any specific local Portland issues. This is just for the state of Oregon. And, of course, we spent a whole program doing a bit on one of the measures, Measure 80, which is
It's the sign behind you, the big green sign next to your head.
Yes. And so you can check out that episode for that measure specifically, which was the legalization of marijuana in the state of Oregon. And I know this, of course, we don't really do a lot of, let's only talk about what's going on here in Portland, because I really want to look at the big picture and kind of put all the pieces together. I think that is so important to do, to look at everything, everywhere, objectively, and practically and just kind of get the big picture, right? But in order to get the big picture, sometimes you do have to go down with a magnifying glass and look at what's going on in Portland, Oregon, for example. Because this, I want to share with this. I had a couple conversations with a couple of friends over the last couple of weeks. They don't know about these things. They have not read their voter pamphlet, which came in the mail to them. Read this freaking thing, or just skim it, you know, whatever. And it's so scary to realize that they don't even know these issues are upon us. And a couple of these are some really egregious crap that these people are trying to push through. And this is scary to me. I want to mention a couple of these things. The first thing that I want to talk about as far as in the state of Oregon specifically is Measure 84, which you really don't hear too much about. Measure 84 is an estate tax break for millionaires, period. And you...
Are you serious?
Yes. And if unless you own a real estate or a home that is worth $1 million, you want to vote no on 84. No on 84. Write that down for everyone in Portland who's listening and playing along at home. That's no on 84.
I mean Oregon, dude. The whole state, right?
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, in Oregon. Right. Thank you, Scott.
There's more of the state of Oregon than just Portland, Jacob.
Yes, you're right. Of course. The rural red areas. no, 84.
Though you may not think so.
84 in the state of Oregon eliminates the estate tax for estates worth more than $1 million and not for anyone else, period. Also, it contains a massive new tax loophole that could allow basically wealthy households to avoid paying any state capital gains taxes on their wealth. This measure is estimated to cost the state of Oregon $240 million every budget cycle. With that money, that $240 million every budget cycle coming out of the state's education fund, the state's health care fund, the state's public safety fund, and the state's services to seniors and people with disabilities. So, do we want to give tax breaks to people who own real estate worth more than $1 million and take that money out of education, health care, public safety, seniors, and disability funds? No. No on 84. Is that not freaking like no duh, right? But how many people know that? How many people know that? By the way, No on 84 is sponsored by AARP Oregon, American Federation of Teachers, Oregon Basic Rights, Economic Fairness Oregon, Oregon FLIC, AFL-CIO, Oregon AFSCME, Oregon Education Association, Oregon LEAD, Oregon League of Conservation Voters, Oregon Nurses Association, Oregon PTA, Oregon State Firefighters Council, our
so
Oregon.
All of labor. Pretty labor supports it.
SEIU, Oregon, period. No on 84. The other thing I want to mention really quick is the casino measures. And this is, Scott, I want your riff on this. Actually.
Yeah, we got one of those here too, man.
Yeah, and this is crazy. And there's two measures on the Oregon ballot about private for-profit casinos. No on 82. I'm strongly recommending a no vote on 82, which would amend the Oregon Constitution to allow privately owned casinos in Oregon. The one that they're trying to build right now in Wood Village, which is like on the edge of the Portland-Vancouver metropolitan area, it's called The Grange, and there's ads freaking everywhere. It's just so burned out on the ads now, back and forth. But this,
yeah, we got the same thing here.
This is a foreign-owned company. This is a foreign company that wants to amend the Oregon Constitution in the United States so that this foreign company can come in and build their own for-profit private casino in the state. Oh, and by the way, they'll sell it to you. Oh, yeah, and we'll be sure to give a little bit of a kickback to the state, and we'll help the kids, and it's going to be okay. Just, you know, build this casino in the metropolitan area of Portland that is going to be bigger than any casino in Vegas.
What?
Seriously.
Bigger than Vegas.
No shit.
Have you ever been to Vegas? It's freaking huge, man.
Never been to Vegas, so I don't know how big casinos are in Vegas, but...
Yeah, you can't... You know, they're so big, you never leave them. I mean, literally, like the hotel... I've been to Vegas once, dude, and, like, we never left our hotel because it's too far to walk.
Yeah.
That's how big the hotel is. And everywhere you go, they're like, you ask someone, hey, where's the bathroom? Hey, where's this restaurant? It always starts off with, well, you go through the casino and you make our left. Or you go through the casino, you go through the casino. Everything is through the casino, man.
Right.
It's insane. But, I mean, I can't imagine it being bigger than something in Vegas in the middle of Oregon. That doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah, it totally doesn't make sense to me. And I'm not even getting into the whole Native American tribal pact that the state of Oregon has with the Native American tribes of the state of Oregon that says basically the Native Americans who their entire lives and their entire legacy and their entire everything was stolen from them and taken away. And you can have this
genocide.
You can have this little casino over here and you can, you know, sustain what's left, which isn't like not much of, you know, your life on this casino. And that's how the pact works in Oregon. I'm not even going to go there, but you just went there. But you know, it's like,
yeah, you did.
But the reason,
you know, we have a question 7 here too, man. It's the exact same thing. It's literally it's a 16,000 unit, what they call, not a video poker, video, you know, table games, you know, it's literally, they're going to build a giant casino. Out, of course, in my county, which is PG County in Maryland, Prince George's County in Maryland, which is historically a poorer county than like Montgomery County and other counties in the area that are, of course, you know, ranked in the top 10 of richest counties in the country. Mm. So this is like sort of the bastard child county, if you will. Also, it's the only county in the country that where African Americans are a majority. In my county, it's 60% African American, 20% Hispanic, and then 20% the rest of us. And so it's unique in that sense. And of course, they're going to build a giant casino in my backyard to exploit everybody.
Right.
And let's face it, it's really, you know, it's just and the propaganda around it says that, oh, we're going to fund schools and this is going to be, all the money is going to go to education. My ass.
Right.
I mean, they literally, like, this is all done through backroom deals, and there literally is an out-of-state organization that's going to run this thing.
Right.
It's insane. And I wonder how many other states are having this issue, because it seems to be, you know, obviously just the two of us as far as we know, but there's got to be more.
Yeah, and you might say to yourself, Jacob Scott, I don't live in D.C. or Maryland. I don't live in Oregon, so whatever you're talking about doesn't matter to me. I want to ask you then to call in our second hour of this program on our brand new fancy pantsy comment line for Filter Free Radio. It is not toll free. Here's the fine print. It's not toll free. It's a Washington, D.C. number. Long distance charges may apply. You're subject to your long distance charges. There's the fine print. Okay. The number is 1-202-6979-FFR. 202-6979-337. And we want to know in the second hour, this is one thing you can call in on the comment line when we take your calls about, what is on your ballot? I already know that Obama and Romney are on your ballot, and I already know probably how you're going to vote. I don't care about that. I want to know what else is on your ballot. What measure are you like, hello, citizens of Florida, citizens of Ohio, citizens of Earth, time to wake up. You know, call us and tell us what's on your ballot, why you want to talk about it, and how you're going to vote. I would love to know. I would love to know. So we'll do that.
Also, it's interesting to know, too, dude, you got pot legalization, and we got gay marriage here in Maryland. That's our ballot initiatives.
Right, right. So, you know, there's progressive, there's really far left progressive actions and ballot measures and things going on around you. Are you aware of that you can get out and get active and support and get behind and rally behind and organize behind? And
at the very least, vote for.
At the very least, vote for. Wake the F up, right?
Or again, or against. I mean, you know.
Or,
but that's the confusing thing about it. I mean, like in our state,
Oregon,
you know, you want to vote. We have like question 6, which is, you know, legalization of gay marriage or civil unions or whatever.
Right.
I'm pretty sure it's actually what they call civil marriage. So it's not even real marriage. But anyway, point is, it's gay rights. And you want to vote yes for that. And then question seven is this giant casino that they want to exploit us with. And you know, of course you vote no on that one. But keeping it all on straight, especially when there's just commercials. I mean, honest to God, dude, I read the other day that they've spent $56 million on an ad campaign just for this state of Maryland for this casino. And that number, the $56 million spent to advertise to please vote for this casino, is greater than all the candidates running in the state of Maryland that they've spent on their ad campaigns.
Wow.
So that should tell you, like, who's behind this kind of shit, you know?
Well, to take it to the big picture really quick before we run to the break at the bottom of the hour here, here's the big picture. The latest figure, the knock your socks off, kicker, whatever you want to call it, the punchline, get ready for this, record-breaking, so far over $5 billion spent on the election campaign so far this year. $3 billion of that going directly to the TV stations. $3 billion in TV ads this year you will watch between now and the next 2 weeks, or, you know, before November, before we vote. So, you know, get ready. It's coming. More Filter Free Radio when we come back, live on filterfreeradio.com. RadioOrNot.com and ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. Got to tell you about what they're doing live tonight during the debate. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Filter Free Radio, unfiltered truth on Radio or Not and FilterFreeRadio.com.
Well, Portland, Oregon, and slow gin fizz. If that ain't love, then tell me what is. Well, I.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or Not.
Radio or Not.
Radio or Not.com.
Radio or Not.com.
Radio or Not.com.
Radio or Not.com.
Let us now assess the state of the free press in this land of, well, of press freedom. The assessment? Pathetic. Not because of some government clampdown, but because of increasing press pusillanimity. The latest decline in hard-nosed investigative reporting is something called, quote, approval. It began with PR flacks for public officials and political candidates, demanding that reporters agree as a price of being granted an interview to submit any quotes they intend to use from the interview to the interviewee's staff for approval. Thus, when Mr. Big blurts out something shocking, stupid, or actually newsworthy, Mr. Big's staff of bowdlerizers can tidy it up or even erase it. Zzzt! It's gone, as though it was never uttered. It's not surprising that today's media-sensitive political figures, including Barack Obama and Mitt Romney, would demand this extraordinary editorial control over what comes out of their own mouths. But it's utterly despicable that media bosses and reporters have so gutlessly caved in to the demand. It reduces reporters from hard-nosed diggers to brown-nosed beggars, and it makes a mockery of our democracy's need for a free press. Yet many of America's major publications have meekly surrendered their reporters' freedom to this restraint. And now, corporate executives have realized that, hey, we can emasculate the press, too. Wall Street barons, Silicon Valley hotshots, and even the bosses of media conglomerates are demanding and getting, quote, approval for stories about their operations. This is Jim Hightower saying, the media columnist for the New York Times admits that he's also succumbed to these demands. If it's a quote I feel I absolutely need, he recently wrote, I start negotiating. Never mind that it's his independence and journalistic integrity he's bargaining away.
Hightower's commentary is brought to you by the Hightower Lowdown. From Wall Street to Washington, this monthly newsletter reveals who's doing what to whom and why. Check it out, hightowerlowdown.org.
Never know who or what you'll hear when you listen to The Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com.
This is Jackson Brown, and you're listening to The Nicole Sandler Show.
This is Melissa Etheridge, and you're listening to my friend, Nicole Sandler.
Hey, this is Rob with Matchbox 20.
Hey, this is Chris Isaac.
Hi, this is Suzanne Vega.
Hey, this is Trey Anastasio, and you're listening to
my friend, Nicole Sandler.
Bare Naked Ladies, you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
What's up? This is Howie Day, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
Hey, this is Henry.
And I'm JoJo.
And I'm Ringo.
And we're Lost Lonely Boys, and you're listening
listening to Nicole Sandler.
This is Kelly from Stereophonics, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
This is Evan Dando of the Lemonheads, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
Hi, my name's Jonathan Brook, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
This is Pat Monahan from the band Train, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
This is Ziggy Marley, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
Hey, this is Pete Yorn, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
The lovely Nicole Sandler.
Nicole Sandler. Nicole is awesome.
The Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com. Music to my ears.
Hi, I'm Jacob Dean, host of Filter Free Radio, your home for unfiltered truth, news, and real conversation about the real issues that matter most. Visit FilterFreeRadio.com for our complete video archive of every episode, the all-new highlights page with special guest interviews, the audio archive, Skeptical Scott's blog, where intellectuals indulge and thinkers thrive, and my blog, which is now syndicated on USAProgressive.com and ForFreedomsBlog.com. Subscribe to Filter Free Radio for free so you automatically never miss a show. Go to youtube.com and type in FFRWJD as in Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean. Don't forget to like us on Facebook for our most current updates and links to the related information we talk about. Follow us on Twitter to help share the unfiltered truth we all need to know. Filter Free Radio is proudly nonprofit and 100% volunteer operated. Filter Free Radio will only grow if you help spread the word. Thank you for all your continued help and support. Grassroots activism from the bottom up. That's what Filter Free Radio is all about.
The More Me Show with DJ Downtown and Eddie Herradura. Live from our nation's capital every Sunday at 5 p.m. Eastern with hilariously scathing inches from the beltway analysis of this week's political and social developments. The More Me Show at ProgressiveBlendRadio.com and RadioOrNot.com.
I'm David Schuster, and this is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott. FilterFreeRadio.com.
And welcome back to Filter Free Radio, broadcasting live on FilterFreeRadio.com, RadioOrNot.com, and ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. And I want to mention our good friends, you heard the spot just there in the break, our good friend DJ Downtown of the More Me Show at ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. The More Me Show is going to be doing a live debate coverage program immediately following this program on ProgressiveBlendRadio.com, because of course tonight is the third presidential debate, and if you want to watch the debate and have some fun and make some jokes and enjoy some cool live commentary, some good progressive, entertaining, comical coverage of the debate, you want to hang around and check out ProgressiveBlendRadio.com as soon as we go off the air. That would be 9 p.m. Eastern and 6 p.m. on Pacific, where I'm at. So there you go. Welcome.
You had to think about that one, didn't you?
Yeah, for just a second there. Welcome back to the show. And Scott and I are here with you. And folks have already started calling the comment line. Hang on. We'll take your calls in the second hour of the program, and we'll be sure to get to you. But I do want to mention really quick before we get into what the heck is going on with the presidential candidates getting arrested outside of the debate, we already have our very first filter-free radio comment line. I'm going to have to come up with a better name than Bit here. And so let's go ahead and try to do this and make it sound cool.
You've got mail.
Stick it in the mailbox. Why don't you stick it in the mailbox and I'll give it to you when I can.
What's this? A letter for me.
All right. So that's going to be our little jingle. Every time we want to play a comment from our comment line, which you can call 24/7 anytime and leave us your voicemail or your message unfiltered. It's you unfiltered. Finally, we the people have an unfiltered outlet, and it is here on Filter Free Radio, you know, nonprofit grassroots radio for we the people. Call 202-6979-FFR. That's 337. This is our first voicemail that we got yesterday, I believe, because I posted this on our Facebook page once I got the number and everything set up. So here's the very first Filter Free Radio comment.
Hey, buddy, just keep up the good work with Filter Free Radio. It's a great show. Love it, man.
Now, you can definitely be that short and brief if you want, or you can leave a little bit more of a message, or you can say whatever you want, or, you know, if one of our... you know, episodes or something strikes you. Like, I have a feeling the legalized marijuana episode struck that viewer and he had to call in. So that's really cool. not the doc, the viewer or anything, but thanks so much, man, for calling in. And you might not have thought we'd play that on the air, but we did. So I hope you heard it. And that goes for everyone else out there who's listening. Or finds us.
Yeah, hopefully we can talk about issues too. It doesn't have to be kudos or anything like that.
Yeah. I would much rather talk about the issues. I want your opinions, and I especially want your opinions if you disagree with us. You know, even more so, I want your opinions if you agree with us and yet can enlighten us from an even further left position. So
that's gonna be hard to do.
Bring it on. I want it all. Bring it on. Okay.
Yeah. We just the goal is to foster discussion, I think.
Yes, and I want your involvement. More participation, the better. I think one of the key issues, and we've talked about this, Scott, on this show many times, that one of the key issues brought about from the Occupy movement is simply where can the public assemble to discuss the issues. Period. And you know, it's seeming that that's like nowhere, and so we're doing our part to make it happen, at least online via the interwebs with you here at filterfreeradio.com. Don't forget, we're going to give away a bumper sticker in about an hour from now, so stick around. And bumper sticker, stick around, whatever. Let's get back to the news, because I'm rambling.
I didn't get that, so.
Amy Goodman. I got to mention this. This is so cool. Just again, because we were talking about Portland just a second ago, for all of my good friends in the Portland area or who can make it to Portland in the next 3 days by Thursday, October 25th, you might want to make your way on down to the Bob White Theater on 64th and Southeast Foster Road, because that is where...
Not a good neighborhood.
Amy Goodman... Thanks, Scott. Amy Goodman, host of Democracy Now! And fearless truth-telling peace advocate journalist. You know,
She's the Walter Cronkite of our generation.
Like, one of my true mentors is on the... she's on a book tour for a new book, The Silenced Majority. I'm going to get to hang out with Amy, hopefully for a couple of minutes next Thursday, and I'll be able to share that with you on our next program next Monday.
And if nothing else, check her out on democracynow.org.
Yeah, here.
The War and Peace Report.
Let me throw up that.
She's honestly, you know, if I get news from no other source but her, I think I'd be more informed than most people. She's just doing absolutely brilliant journalism. And it's not just her, it's democracynow.org entirely, but it's just a great, great program.
Watch Democracy Now! And The Daily Show with Jon Stewart, the two shows that this show endorses you watching every day.
yeah, pretty much.
All right, so back to why I want to mention Amy Goodman. Her piece last Thursday on truthdig.com, titled Binders Full of Women and Two Women Bound, caught my attention and is a brilliant article. And I wanted to bring this up because Scott and I spent a few minutes talking about how the League of Women's Voters in the 80s were in control of the presidential debates, and that was taken from them. We talked a little bit about that a couple weeks ago, but we didn't really have all the facts and all the jazz set, and I kind of felt kind of bad about just, oh yeah, and by the way, I think that the Democratic and Republican Party were just bullies, and they stole the control of the debates from the League of Women's Voters in the 80s because, you know, they wanted to control the debate, but we didn't have all the facts and all the jazz.
Well, Ross Perot substantially embarrassed both parties, and so no more Ross Perots are allowed in the debate. So that's why you will never see more than, or anybody other than the two parties debating. That's just the way it is now.
Amy Goodman really broke it down, and I want to read a little bit from the article for you. And she starts off with what happened with what happened at outside the last presidential debate, the second one, the most recent, the town hall debate. You may and she starts off the article by writing, "You may have noticed that the Green Party presidential candidate, Dr. Jill Stein, was absent from the town hall presidential debate at Hofstra University the other night. That's because she was shackled to a chair in a nearby New York police facility, along with her running mate, Green Party vice president nominee Sherry Hunkela. Their crime was attempting to enter the debate so Dr. Jill Stein could participate. Amy Goodman, host of Democracy Now!, interviewed Jill Stein the day after the debate, after the imprisonment, which ironically was not long after or the imprisonment ended not long after the debate was over. Ironic. Jill Stein told Amy Goodman, quote, "We are on the ballot for 85% of voters in the country. Americans deserve to know what their choices are. The police said they were only doing their job. I said this is about everyone's jobs, whether we can afford health care, whether students will be indentured. There are critical issues left out of the debate. 90 million voters are predicted to stay home and vote with their feet that neither Barack Obama nor Mitt Romney represent them. That's twice as many voters than expected for either of them." End quote. And then Amy Goodman goes on to mention that even if Jill Stein and Sherry Hunkela had not been arrested in and handcuffed and put in jail for those 8 hours during the debate, even if that hadn't happened, we know for sure that they would have been excluded from the debate because the debates are very closely controlled by the Commission on Presidential Debates. It's abbreviated CPD. Remember this, the Commission on Presidential Debates. This commission is the commission that excludes all of the third-party candidates, among other things, from the debates. Amy Goodman, in her article on TruthDig, .com interviewed George Farah, I believe is how you pronounce the name, F-A-R-A-H. He's the founder and executive director of Open Debates and author of the book No Debate, How the Republican and Democratic Parties Secretly Controlled the Presidential Debates. Sounds like a guy we should get on this program and interview, Scott. George Farva told Amy Goodman on the morning of the second presidential town hall debate about how the Commission on Presidential Debates, the CPD, gained control over the debates in the 80s from the nonpartisan independent League of Women's Voters. And we have, and he says, quote, "We have a private corporation that was created by Republican and Democratic parties called the Commission on Presidential Debates. It seized control of the presidential debates precisely because the league was independent." He's referring to the League of Women's Voters, was independent. "Precisely because this women's organization had the guts to stand up to the candidates that the major parties had nominated." Now, and this is what Scott is talking about, when he mentions Ross Perot. "The League of Women's Voters allowed third-party candidate John B. Anderson to participate in the debate in 1980, and in the debate that followed, the two major parties, the Republican and Democrat, of course, they fought with the league over it. And then in the following, in 1988, the parties tried to force the league into a contract detailing, into a contract detailing how the debates would be ran. And he, George Farva, explained it this way, quote, "It talked about who could be in the audience, how the format would be structured, and that the League of Women's Voters found that that kind of lacked transparency," oh, no shit, "and that kind of candidate control to be fundamentally outrageous and antithetical to the democratic process. They released the contract and stated the League of Women's Voters released the contract that the Democratic and Republican Party, through the CPD, the Commission on Presidential Debates, tried to push on them. They released that contract publicly and stated that they refused to be an accessory to the hoodwinking of the American people and refused to implement it.
Wow. Now, when was that? What year is that again?
That is 88, 1988. That's a damn good year, okay. By the way. 1988, best year ever.
you're showing your age.
I only want to read one more little section of this article, and then I want Scott to riff on this for a minute, the big picture here. George Farva, interviewed by Amy Goodman, says basically that early contract was, quote, tame compared to the binding contract that leaked to Time magazine last week that governed the so-called town hall meeting that was moderated by CNN's Candy Crowley. That CPD, the Commission on Presidential Debates, issued a binding contract for the most recent presidential debate that was 21 pages long. A 21-page memorandum of understanding included a reference to the standards for the candidate eligibility to participate, a.k.a. Let's exclude everyone but the Democrats and Republicans. The CPD required that a candidate must have support from at least 15% of the national electorate as determined by five selected national public opinion polling organizations. Whoa, is that not a catch-22? Do you get what's going on here? In order to debate, you must have at least broad support of 15%. But in order to earn that broad support in the public at least 15%, candidates without huge frickin' campaign war chests, cash without the funding, they need access to the televised debates. They can't get 15% of the vote. They can't reach that many people without participating in the televised debates, which reaches the most amount of viewers. So, the Democrats and the Republicans control the debates. They limit the public's access to alternative views. And you and I are stuck between a rock and a hard place because they want you and I to think that if we vote for a third party, we're going to throw away our vote. I want you to think what the textbook definition of insanity is, which is repeating the same process, doing the same thing over and over and over again, and expecting a different result. That is the textbook definition of insanity, insane. Or I would say, the textbook definition of throwing away your vote would be voting for the same thing over and over and over again and expecting something different to happen. So, I will throw in a little disclaimer for our good friends maybe in Ohio, Kenny Pick and Tom Schaefer and good friends in Ohio. In battleground states, even Noam Chomsky said the folks in battleground states need to vote for Obama.
And Daniel Ellsberg, too. All those guys.
I'll say, Kenny and Tom and folks in Ohio, vote for Obama to secure an Obama presidency. But anyone who's in a, like blue state, like Oregon, that's not a battleground state, vote for a third party candidate and make your voice really heard and show them that we need a fundamentally new election process. How about my particular favorite solution is proportional representational democracy. Maybe one day we can get into that. But so, Scott, do you want to riff on this little riff here for a minute?
I was going to. It's interesting. Truthdig.com is still down. Oh, there it goes. It loaded. Because I was thinking about this. There was a good article on, I think it was either Truthdig or CommonDreams.org, that was titled, and I can't find the title, so it won't be right. But it was something like "Vote for Obama, but let's not be let's not have any illusions about what we're doing here."
Right.
It's not like in 2008 where we all voted for him and we were like, "Yay, hope and change." I campaigned for him. I gave him $200 and the whole nine. It's now, you know, God, Mitt Romney is just, he is the 1%. I mean, nothing exemplifies the 1% more than this guy. But by the same token, Obama serves the 1% as well. So it's different. It's a little different because he's not a 1%er. He's more of a servant, whereas Mitt Romney is completely, you know, a 1%er. But the point I'm trying to make here is that if you're in a swing state, we do need the lesser of two evils because we don't need to go any farther into the hole than we're already going at this point. And I mean, literally, you know, I'm confident that Mitt Romney would repeal the New Deal in its entirety, even though it's almost dead at this point.
Or he will at least just rubber stamp whatever the Republican Congress gives him, which is scary crap coming out of that shit.
Yeah, it's all batshit crazy. I mean, you know, we're talking about, we're literally talking about rolling back, going back to the 20s where, you know, there's no EPA. There's no FCC, there's no FDA, there's no oversight, there's nothing. I mean, it's bad enough they're all corrupt and bought off and completely captured by industry now anyway. And I've talked to people in the EPA who would verify that. It's just that with the Romney presidency, you can assure that it will get much, much worse before it gets better.
Yeah.
I think at the very least with Obama in office, there is the possibility that we can push him to do something. And that's what we have to really, you know, look at in terms of why we're electing him versus Romney. And as someone who's more amicable to the will of the people, provided we agitate and for that and get active and organize and protest and let them know that, hey, you don't do this, you're not going to be elected and so on. And so it's really basically shame them. And that's really what it comes down to, is shaming these public officials into doing the right thing, the moral thing, the greater good, if you will, and not just what they're paid to do by these large multinationals who fund their elections and build libraries like the Clinton Library, et cetera, you know, for these people when they retire and give them these golden parachutes. So let's not be disillusioned about who the Democratic Party and you know, President Obama is. And I think even in a much larger sense, I don't even like talking about the two people as people so much, because they're really just placeholders of power. They don't make decisions, based on, their moral compass or who they are in any fashion.
Yep.
They merely reflect. They do the bidding of those who control them. And unfortunately, we the people don't control them the way we should. They're being controlled by the very wealthy, the 1%. Or it's actually, quite frankly, it's the 0.00001%. It's really a minute. I think the number is actually 4,000 people in the country have some insane amount of 90% of wealth.
Well, Scott, right before we came on the air, you told me a new system. New statistic that I've never heard before that just blew my freaking mind. What was it? Like the 10 richest people in America can... What was that?
Oh, I got to find that. Damn it. Yeah, it's a good article. It is on commondreams.org.
It's words to the effect of the 10 richest Americans who made the most money last year, in just last year alone, in 1 year of income, the 10 richest could afford to feed every single a hungry, starving person on the planet for an entire year.
the article came out last Monday. It's on commondreams.org. It's actually on their most viewed list. It's called Five Ways Deregulation is Ripping America Apart. And it's by Paul Buscheit, whose name I'm probably not pronouncing right. But one of the points he makes, which is very, very clear and very hard to even comprehend, that is the 10 richest Americans. It's 10 frickin' people. Made enough money last year. And that's just their income, their capital gains, or whatever the hell they call it. Doesn't include their net worth. You know, this is just the money they made last year. They made enough money last year to feed every hungry person on Earth for 1 year. So the 10 richest Americans, they made $50 billion last year. And that is according to the Food and Agriculture Organization and the United Nations.
Sorry.
Yeah, it's all right, man.
Go ahead.
Including to the UN, the UN's World for Food Program, they made enough money, $50 million, to feed $50 billion in 1 year to feed 870 million starving people in the world. And that number, 870 million people in the world who are lacking sufficient food, that's almost three times the amount of the population in the United States. And we're talking 10 people here, you know, 10 individuals. And that's just from last year. That doesn't even dig into their over and out net worth. Doesn't even touch all the money they have. That just wipes out their income for 1 year. So that, if you can even wrap your head around that, just a smidge of where we are in this global economy in terms of the absolute, just the subjugation of the rest of us for these minor, very small number of individuals who are, I mean, I don't know about you, but what, $50 billion, that means each one of those guys made $5 billion last year.
On the average.
For 10 people. Yeah, on the average.
Yeah.
For 10 people.
Yeah.
$5 billion. I mean, that's, with a B, that's, you know, $5,000 million. It's just,
and here we are, you know, fighting over lottery tickets in hopes of trying to win $1 million.
Because I mean, here we are,
we'd be set for life with $1 million,
yeah,
right?
Arguing whether a casino in our community is going to raise enough money to put our kids through public schools. I
right.
mean, that's what the casino they're advertising here is for. They're going to build more schools and better educate your kids. My ass,
right?
You know, it's like right. Wow. Meanwhile, I mean, the dichotomy of wealth, it's unfathomable. I can't even wrap my head around that amount of money. I mean, $50 billion. You can go around the budgets and the for states and local. I mean, we could all have free healthcare. We could all have free education. We could all, you know, have it's mind boggling. And so it's one of those things just to keep in mind when we're dealing with this political environment where it's like, why aren't the Democrats doing the right thing? How can they justify this immoral, you know, they are the lesser of two evils kind of thing? And it's because people with this kind of money, $50 billion,
yeah,
you know, they control things. And our $20, our $100 is just a fart in the wind.
oh, God, how come I don't have my fart queued up? Come on. So
my point in a larger sense here, real quick, if I can wrap it all up, is just that keep in mind how insignificant, I would say how almost insignificant the presidential election is. Not insignificant in the sense that we're going to elect somebody who won't take us back to the Stone Age.
Right.
But insignificant in the sense that no matter who we elect, they're still controlled by the 1%. And that unless we agitate for our own well-being and take control back, we're doomed either way. So we can vote for Obama, but keep in mind that that's just the beginning of where we start in order to bring about change. That's getting him back in office and then forcing him, you know, like Bill McKibben did. They surrounded the White House with the tar sands pipeline, and Obama actually postponed the pipeline. You know, so that those little acts right there are successful, and that's one of the things to keep in mind. So
that's exactly what you're talking about. That's exactly what I'm talking about, Scott. That's exactly what the folks in the chat room are talking about right now. And we've talked about this many times. It doesn't matter which, I might get in trouble for using this word, but which puppet you vote for, whether it be Obama or Jill Stein or Rocky Anderson or Gary Johnson or Mitt Romney or who the hell is Will Christensen? But anyways, if you vote for one of those guys, you're just voting for a puppet. And we need to talk about the puppet masters who are pulling the strings behind the scenes. That's where the real issues are going on. More Filter Free Radio when we come back live on filterfreeradio.com, radioornot.com, and progressiveblendradio.com. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Looking for filters? Check your coffee maker. This is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
Hi, I'm Jacob Dean, host of Filter Free Radio, your home for unfiltered truth, news, and real conversation about the real issues that matter most. Visit filterfreeradio.com for our complete video archive of every episode, the all-new highlights page with special guest interviews, the audio archive, Skeptical Scott's blog, where intellectuals indulge and thinkers thrive, and my blog, which is now syndicated on usaprogressive.com and forfreedomsblog.com. Subscribe to Filter Free Radio for
for free, so you automatically never miss a show. Go to youtube.com and type in FFRWJD, as in Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean. Don't forget to like us on Facebook for our most current updates and links to the related information we talk about. Follow us on Twitter to help share the unfiltered truth we all need to know. Filter Free Radio is proudly nonprofit and 100% volunteer operated. Filter Free Radio will only grow if you help spread the word. Thank you for all your continued help and support. Grassroots activism from the bottom up. That's what Filter Free Radio is all about.
You're listening to WIN, the Workers' Independent News Service. I'm Jesse Russell. One of the most traumatic impacts of mountaintop removal coal mining in Appalachia is the destruction of family cemeteries, some of which are centuries old. As Melinda Tuhus reports from southern West Virginia, some people have taken up the fight to save them.
Mountaintop removal mining is one form of strip mining in which the tops of mountains are literally blown off to get to the coal seams beneath. Danny Cook tells the story of his family's cemetery on Cook Mountain in Boone County, West Virginia, where his family lived for eight generations.
It started back in 2007. They started strip mining around my family cemetery. And I went up there to get them registered. And when I went up there that day, they stopped me from going to my family cemetery. The coal company told me I couldn't go because I was trespassing on coal company's property. Told me if I didn't get off the mountain, they was going to call the law, get me arrested for trespassing. I said, well, I said, do what you have to do. I said, I'm going to my family cemetery. And I went, I got pictures, I got all the information I need from the cemetery, and I got them registered.
Cook said his family visited the cemetery often, paying their respects and holding picnics and other events there. He was able to get it registered with the State Historic Preservation Office, or SHPO. He explains the consequences of not registering a family cemetery located in a mining area.
If they ain't registered by SHPO in Charleston, the state can do whatever they want to with the cemeteries. The coal companies can do anything. Housing developments, gas drilling, they can just come in, doze the cemetery over, and then it'd be up to you to prove they was cemetery there or not.
This was an issue that motivated Larry Gibson to fight mountaintop removal on his own property, Cayford Mountain. Gibson, who is considered the father of the movement opposing mountaintop removal, died of a heart attack in September and was remembered at an event in October in Charleston. One of the speakers was Dustin White, Denny Cook's nephew, who was also involved in the fight to preserve cemeteries.
And now I know that when I stand at the edge of the graves of my ancestors and look northeast, look over the valley of the vanished town of Lindytown, look across the demolishment of Cook Mountain, look beyond Montcoal Mountain's murdered body and the endangered Coal River Mountain, there is Cayford Mountain, and I know Larry will be looking back at me.
You've been listening to WIN, the Workers' Independent News. For more information, visit laborradio.org.
Hi, this is Kenny Pick from Turn of the Night. Here are some of the hijinks you can expect from my show.
Also, news just recently came out about a 15-year-old girl, I think, over in the UK.
Yeah!
Who's only eating McNuggets, and this 15-year-old...
Did she, like, get real sick?
Yeah, her, like, tongue swelled up and she collapsed.
Then what's the technical medical term for eating nothing but chicken nuggets?
I think that would be suicide.
Turn Up the Night with Kenny Pick, streaming live every Tuesday and Friday from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern at Radio or Not, Talk Radio 1, Progressive Blend Radio, and KennyPick.com.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or Not.
Radio or Not.
RadioOrNot.com.
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 This is it. You're listening to Jacob Dean, streaming live on the web.
It's our job to very coldly assess reality and then figure out how to respond.
We bring you the real stuff.
And if we have this naive belief that in the inevitability of human progress or that science and technology will take care of us, then we're doomed.
You're listening to Jacob.
Look, I mean, we don't have much time left. And yet, what are we doing? It's a kind of willful suicide. It's that twilight period that grips civilizations when they just disconnect from what's happening around them. The walls literally go down and they don't see it.
You're listening to Jacob.
Talk about resistance. I think we have to stand up now and carry out acts of nonviolent resistance. It's incumbent upon those of us at this point to do anything, however futile it may appear.
Streaming live on the web.
All of us who care about maintaining a peaceful and an open society.
This is it.
Begin to carry out these kinds of acts, even if they're lonely acts.
And welcome back to Filter Free Radio. We are broadcasting live from Portland and Washington, D.C. Jacob Dean, Skeptical Scott here with you. So good to be with you live on our website, filterfreeradio.com. Also the home of Nicole Sandler, radioornot.com. And syndicated as well on a third outlet, on another awesome radical truth-telling website that you should check out, and that is progressiveblendradio.com. Reason you should check out that program is immediately following this program, 1 hour from now, progressiveblendradio.com will go live with the More Me Show and DJ Downtown and a really interesting a political debate. Tonight's the third debate. They're going to be covering the debate with some awesome, funny commentary. You definitely want to hang around and check out progressiveblendradio.com immediately following our program here on Filter Free Radio. You know, it's just, hey, it's another grassroots, bottom-up activism, independent, nonprofit radio media source out there, and that's what I'm all about, baby. So I want to help out the team, as far as I see it, in any way possible we can. I want to throw up the telephone number, because in a couple of minutes, we're going to start taking your calls on our brand new filter-free radio comment line. It is not toll-free, so your long-distance charges will apply to this DC area phone number that you can call, 202-6979-FFR, which translates to 337. You unfiltered. Make your voice heard on the filter-free radio comment line. We'll get to you next, right after we ask the question, why the heck don't we have any candidates running for president that sound like this?
And this is the time. It is the time for this land to become again a witness to the world for what is just and noble in human affairs. It is time to live more with faith and less with fear, with an abiding confidence that can sweep away the strongest barriers between us and teach us that we are truly brothers and sisters. So join with me in this campaign. Lend Senator Eagleton and me your strength and your support, and together we will call America home to the ideals that nourished us from the very beginning.
That is the late Senator George McGovern, who passed away yesterday at the age of 90. You can find all sorts of progressive commentators and bloggers all over the internet sharing their stories of Senator McGovern, who passed away yesterday. They're all over. Chris Hedges, John Nichols. They've all written some really brilliant pieces, and Scott and I do have the Chris Hedges article from truthdig.com, and we want to kind of go through this a little bit. I know Scott's got a couple of things that he wants to share from the article. And
yeah!
Hang on, man. Let me get your... I've got it here ready. Oh, here we go.
Yeah!
There you go. Sorry about that.
Thanks, man. I gotta get my sound box back.
We'll get that going, man. And that'd be good to have you back in action on the box. But Chris Hedges' article today at Truth Dig is titled "McGovern: He Never Sold His Soul." And you know, when was the last time you could vote for a politician that you knew hadn't sold their soul yet? Or why don't we have candidates who
for 40 years
tell it like it is? You know what I mean? I don't know. I wanted to do a little bit about this and kind of show you an example of what a real progressive liberal Democrat used to sound like. I mean, this guy won the presidential nomination for the Democratic Party in 1972. It was...
it's just remarkable. I mean, we're talking about 40 years ago at the height of the Vietnam War, you know, at the time when Nixon said, "Ah, get us out of Vietnam. I have a plan. Just elect me. And it's a secret plan. I can't tell you what it is." You know, and there's actually somebody on the national level on what a friend of mine calls speaking politicians. You know, there's a lot of politicians, people who work behind the scenes on Capitol Hill and whatnot on the state, you know, state levels as well, that are politicians that don't speak. They're not in public. But in terms of speaking politicians, where the rhetoric that's out there on a national stage by a national party, the Democratic Party at that, saying these things. If I could just read one quote for you for a second here. It's worth noting that, and this, of course, I'm getting this from Hedges' article on truthdig.com. And again, I didn't know much about George McGovern until he became ill and it became newsworthy that he was passing. And you know, and you look back and you learn about this individual and you're just like, oh my God, there's nobody like this in politics today. I mean, these are people who literally, the line here was, here's a politician who cared more for his country and human decency than he ever did about his political ambitions or his career. It's like, you know, back in the day when you thought that politics was a way to do the greater good, was a way to make a difference in the world, people went into politics. I mean, it's an ugly business, but they did it anyway. I mean, and not everybody. Certainly, I mean, you know, it's, let's face it, there's, you know, power always attracts the incompetent and the sleazy and the venal, like George Bush. You know, but by the same token, there were those individuals out there. You at least had some small, minute counterbalance. And in this case, it was a huge counterbalance because it was the whole Democratic Party and it was on a national scale. And of course, we're talking 40 years ago. And Vietnam is not dissimilar to the many wars we have going now, albeit it was the draft. I mean, the draft made it far more personal for most people. And that was, you know, that's the whole, I'm getting in the weeds here, but the point about that is that we don't have a draft because we'd all be engaged in the war at that point, and right. Then there wouldn't be a war.
Right.
I mean, let's face it, you do a draft, the war's over, no one's going to be drafted. So, but in any case, the quote that George McGovern had on the floor, he inserted an amendment in 1970. He attached into the military procurement bill called the McGovern-Hatfield Amendment that were required through the cutoff of funding, a withdrawal of all American forces from Indochina. And of course, Indochina back then is, you know, Cambodia, Laos, Vietnam, etc. And you're literally just going to cut the funding for the wars. Of course, the amendment didn't pass, although a majority of Americans supported it. And McGovern denounced on the Senate floor the politicians who refused to support his amendment and by proxy, you know, prolonged the war. And here's a quote. It's just remarkable. He said, quote, "Every senator in this chamber is partially responsible for sending 50,000 young Americans to an early grave. This chamber reeks of blood. Every senator here is partly responsible for that human wreckage at Walter Reed Hospital or Bethesda Naval Hospital or any other military hospitals across this land. Young men without legs, arms, or genitals, or faces, or hopes. They are not very many of these blasted and broken boys who think this war is a glorious adventure. Don't talk to them about bugging out or national honor or courage. It doesn't take any courage at all for a congressman or a senator or a president to wrap himself in the flag and say, hey, we're staying in Vietnam because it's not our blood that's being shed, but we are all responsible for these young men and their lives and their hopes. And if we do not end this damnable war, those young men will someday curse us for our pitiful willingness to let the executive carry the burden that the Constitution places on us." And of course, McGovern's moral condemnation was greeted in the chamber by stunned silence, and one senator even told McGovern that he was personally offended by his remarks. And George McGovern answered, "That's what I meant to do." And, you know, it's like the point here is that, you know, here's an individual on a national scale who was shaming, literally shaming his compatriots, his cohorts, you know, for their actions. And at least was able to get his word out, even if, of course, he failed. He ultimately failed. And he lost 49 out of 50 states to Nixon in 72, which is a real depressing thought about. You know, if you think it's bad now, you know, it was equally bad 40 years ago in that sense. So
I want to
everything goes in cycles, though. And I think people like McGovern should give us hope that there are there are politicians that we can bring to the fore that will eventually do our bidding and will actually do the right thing and carry some sort of moral compass. But there are those people out there. We just have to find them and get them in the office.
Here is the second George McGovern clip I want to share with you. And then I have a surprise for a brand new listener in the chat room, Worker 12, about what they're talking about in the chat room right now. Here is the late Senator George McGovern.
From secrecy and deception in high places, come home, America. From military spending so wasteful that it weakens our nation, come home, America. From the entrenchment of special privilege and tax favoritism, from the waste of idle hands to the joy of useful labor, from the prejudice based on race and sex, from the loneliness of the aging poor and the despair of the neglected sick, come home, America. Come home to the affirmation that we have a dream. Come home to the conviction that we can move our country forward. Come home to the belief that we can seek a newer world. And let us be joyful in the homecoming. For this land is your land. This land is my land. From California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me.
There you go. There you go.
Wow, a president actually quoting Woody Guthrie. That's
a presidential candidate.
I'm sorry, a presidential candidate. Okay, a national politician quoting Woody Guthrie. How's that?
There you go. There you
yeah,
go.
That's just that's awesome.
So as we're talking about how awesome candidates used to sound like, and of course we're referencing the late George Senator George McGovern, who passed yesterday, we have a new listener in the chat room, Worker 12, who mentions in the chat room, well, then FDR must have been a god. I want to draw your attention to the FDR re-election poster that is behind me on the wall that says vote for FDR, first of all. That's that. And second of all, Worker 12 mentions, well, I want to hear some of those old clips of FDR that Tom Hartman plays. Well, I don't know if Worker 12 knows this, but I, for the last four or 5 years, I was the Tom Hartman associate producer, the board op. You ever heard Tom say, hey, Jacob, got that FDR clip? I was that Jacob guy running around behind the scenes. And so you want FDR, my freaking favorite president ever, the only president to be elected four times, the president who caused us to have presidential election limits, term limits for the president, and the president who died in office because, well, he was ill, but he's the only president to die in office. I mean, he would have been reelected another time. The people freaking loved him. Okay, here you go.
We have to struggle with the old enemies of peace, business and financial monopoly, speculation, reckless banking, class antagonism, sectionalism, war profiteering. They had begun to consider the government of the United States as a mere appendage to their own affairs. And we know now that government by organized money is just as dangerous as government by organized mob.
Now, I don't talk about the Tom Hartman gig or whatever all the time. It's just some people know, some people don't know. And so you probably most famously are referencing this clip, which is my favorite clip, and I got to play it on Tom's show.
I welcome their hatred.
All the time, and you just listen to the minute-long applause after this clip from then-President FDR, who's really laying it down and said, look, this is what it is, period.
Never before in all our history have these forces been so united against one candidate as they stand today. They are unanimous in their hate for me, and I welcome their hatred.
See, I knew the applause was long enough so I could roll back and point at my FDR picture. Yeah, that's the only president you'll see on the background of this studio.
Yeah, it's so, the reason we have term limits.
Yeah, there you go, you know.
Although I will confess, too, delving back into FDR, and of course he's not a man without some flaws, and that is that at the time, and you know, you bring up FDR, which is so analogous to where we are today, because we really are economically, socially, you know, legally in the same predicament of 1929, you know, where our government was largely captured by Wall Street and large corporations and large interests. The difference now, unfortunately, is it's on a multinational scale, but the issues are still the same. And at the time, you know, FDR really only did the things that he did with the New Deal and all this populist rhetoric that you hear coming from him because there was grassroots activism. There was the Wobblies, the CIOs, the Big Bill Hayworths, the Fighting Bobs. You know, there was all these anarchists and communists and socialists and fill in the blank. There was a huge, huge organization of grassroots people. He was essentially, FDR was essentially forced into doing what he did with the New Deal. And one of the analogies I've heard is that, or at least rather the best explanations, if you will, was from Richard Wolff, economist Richard Wolff, who I'm a huge fan of and who does a weekend update every Saturday at noon on WBAI in New York. Anyway, Richard Wolff explained it as such that, you know, FDR said he basically brokered a deal between the people, if you will, you know, the communists and the socialists and things, and the ruling elites, and said, "Hey, look," you know, went to the ruling elites and said, "Hey, look, if you don't give these people, you know, 40-hour work week, you know, a minimum wage, and a social safety net, and all these things that come with the New Deal, you're going to lose any power you have whatsoever because these communists are coming down the pike here, and they're going to take over, and that's going to be the end of your reign." And so let's throw these people a bone, you know. And so that's in a nutshell, and I'm oversimplifying it, of course, the way it worked. Because let's face it, if nothing had been done, and there was no New Deal, there was such a huge groundswell that there might have been a coup, there might have been a revolution, who's to say what happened? But the fact of the matter is, we got the New Deal because we advocated for it. Because we pushed for it, because people were scared, the very, very wealthy were scared that if they didn't capitulate something, that they would just be overthrown. I mean, you know, you find your heads on pikes or whatever, God forbid, you know, 18th century thing that there would happen to these people. And so they acquiesced and it gave us a little bit. And the analogy today that I think of is the legalization of marijuana and gay rights. It's sort of like, oh, we'll give you these two things, but you're never going to lose your Fourth Amendment. You know, you're not going to have the living wage. You're not going to have health care. You're not going to have housing. You're not going to have all right. The things we take for granted as considered the American dream. But hey, we can smoke pot and get gay married. Right. You know, so that's sort of the point. My point of saying all that, I'm not trying to belittle any of those struggles because they are struggles and they are valid ones. But the point is that without large grassroots organizations pushing these so-called politicians to do the will of the people. There is no will. The will that these politicians adhere to are the will of those who write their paychecks, and it's not you and I. Mm-hmm. And so that's something we have to take back. And voting is just the first step of getting somebody amicable in office that we can mold. And the second step is making them do it. So it's like FDR famously said, you know, make me do it. And a lot of people did. And so we need to make Obama do it. That's the bottom line.
Yeah, I love that point, Scott. It doesn't matter who gets elected in the sense that we still all have to show up, get active, get energized, man on the street, grassroots, bottom up activism, push whoever it is elected, push them in the direction that you want your representative to go. That's how our government's supposed to work.
Yeah, that's the whole thing of vote. I mean, you know, how much time do you spend thinking or talking about this electoral cycle? And really, even, you know, all the intelligence, the Noam Chomsky's of the world say, not more than 15 minutes.
Right.
He's like, you know, you figure out who you're going to vote for, you vote, and you get back out in the streets and you advocate. Because you know, it's voting is the least of the things we do. It's become such a spectacle that we were made to feel as if voting is all we have, when it's really the least of what we have.
Yep.
You know, you vote, and then you get out there and you make these people do it. And you make them do it by things like surrounding the White House in a human chain and saying, look, President, you know, stop the tar sands pipeline. You do it by people like Daryl Hannah out there physically putting their bodies on the line to stop the tar sands pipeline from coming through, using eminent domain to come through people's backyards in Texas and other parts of the Midwest to build this so-called pipeline. And I'm just using that as an example. I mean, there's many, many issues out there. And that is, in part, the problem, is the fact that there are so many issues. It's really hard to know where to begin. But I think finding common ground, for a lot of things, and I find myself even saying things that sound, what's the word I'm looking for here, Jacob?
Libertarian.
Yeah, I mean, I hate labels, but it's like, yeah. Oh my God, I sound like a libertarian, jeez. But you know, you start thinking about these things, and you realize that, wow, there's a lot of crossover here that we can all kind of agree on, you know, and it's just finding that common ground to say, well, we can all agree on corruption, let's work on corruption. We can all agree, I think, on the environment. I think we need clean air and water, let's work on that. You know, so let's find these issues and then advocate for them. But really, all we have left is civil disobedience, it's really all we've ever had, quite frankly. If you look back through history and understand the movements are the way things are changed, the civil rights movement, the women's movement, and so on. And so, and the right, you know, the abolitionist movement to get rid of slavery. And these things at the time were thought to be, you know, a dream. I mean, come on, how many slaves have you went back and said, oh, you know, don't you want to be free? Like, yeah, right. Like, freedom's an option for me. but you see what I mean? So like, and that's, of course, in that context, in that time frame. And then, so we have to look outside of our context and our time frame and our lot and say, where are we historically and what can we do about it? And then get to doing, and then ask how we can do it, and then get to doing it. And I think that's going to come. I'm really hopeful, and quite frankly, I can't believe how optimistic I am these days, because there are so many people out there advocating, and Occupy is a prime example, and the Green Movement is getting active again. And so find what your passion is, find what you're good at, and get out there and get active. And that means getting in the streets, man. That means protests. That means strikes. Mm. That means whatever you can do. But really, democracy is in the streets. It's not in the voting booth.
Boom. On that note, Skeptical Scott, brilliant, dude. You're going to get the last word here before we go to the break at the bottom of the hour. I want to go ahead and throw open our comment line for anyone who wants to give us a call. Call now. When we come back from the break, we'll take your calls at 1-202-6979-FFR, 202-6979-337. Filter Free Radio live on filterfreeradio.com, radioornot.com, and progressiveblendradio.com. We'll be right back. Don't go anywhere.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.
RadioOrNot.com.
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 The More Me Show with DJ Downtown and Eddie Herradura. Live from our nation's capital every Sunday at 5 p.m. Eastern. With hilariously scathing inches from the beltway analysis of this week's political and social developments. The More Me Show at ProgressiveBlendRadio.com and RadioOrNot.com.
Come experience the next generation of progressive voices weekday nights on Nicole Sandler's primetime lineup at RadioOrNot.com. Liberate yourself with Filter Free Radio, hosted by Jacob Dean every Monday night.
It's just the system is broken. This
Bring it down. Bring it all down, right?
On Wednesday nights, take a sharp progressive turn and join Talking Left with Danielle and Shano.
All those Republicans are anti-capitalist.
All of a sudden. Well, no, they're just anti-Romney.
Exactly.
and it's interesting to watch the three-legged stool splinter.
Then let it all hang out both Tuesday and Friday nights on Turn Up the Night with Kenny Pick.
You love the Constitution so much, but you hate the government, but you love the corporations. Where does that come from?
Tune in to the primetime Radio or Not lineup weekday nights at the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, radioornot.com.
I'm sorry, I just find the whole thing so ironic and so mind-bending, it's just ridiculous.
Happy with what you got, because the owners of this country don't want that. I'm talking about the real owners now. The real owners, the big wealthy business interests that control things and make all the important decisions. Forget the politicians. The politicians are put there to give you the idea that you have freedom of choice. You don't. You have no choice. You have owners. They own you. They own everything. They own all the important land. They own and control the corporations. They've long since bought and paid for the Senate, the Congress, the state houses, the city halls. They got the judges in their back pockets. And they own all the big media companies, so they control just about all of the news and information you get to hear. They got you by the balls. They spend billions of dollars every year lobbying to get what they want. Well, we know what they want. They want more for themselves and less for everybody else. But I'll tell you what they don't want. They don't want a population of citizens capable of critical thinking. They don't want well-informed, well-educated people capable of critical thinking. They're not interested in that. That doesn't help them. That's against their interest. They don't want people who are smart enough to sit around the kitchen table and figure out how badly they're getting fucked by a system that threw them overboard 30 fucking years ago. They don't want that. You know what they want? They want obedient workers. People who are just smart enough to run the machines and do the paperwork and just dumb enough to passively accept all these increasingly shittier jobs with the lower pay, the longer hours, the reduced benefits, the end of overtime, and the vanishing pension that disappears the minute you go to collect it. And now they're coming for your Social Security money. They want your fucking retirement money. They want it back so they can give it to their criminal friends on Wall Street. And you know something? They'll get it. They'll get it all from you sooner or later, because they own this fucking place. It's a big club, and you ain't in it. You and I are not in the big club. By the way, it's the same big club they use to beat you over the head with all day long, where they tell you what to believe. All day long, beating you over the head in their media, telling you what to believe, what to think, and what to buy. The table is tilted, folks. The game is rigged. And nobody seems to notice. Nobody seems to care. Good, honest, hardworking people continue to elect these rich cocksuckers who don't give a fuck about them. They don't give a fuck about you. They don't give a fuck about you. They don't care about you at all. At all. At all. Nobody seems to notice. Nobody seems to care. That's what the owners count on. The fact that Americans will probably remain willfully ignorant of the big red, white, and blue dick that's being jammed up their assholes every day. Because the owners of this country know the truth. It's called the American dream, because you have to be asleep to believe it.
Never know who or what you'll hear when you listen to the Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com.
Bill Maher, you're here in Miami on Friday night. You're doing a show at the Fillmore at the Jackie Gleason Theater. They just renamed this theater the Fillmore. And they put up a couple of psychedelic posters, so I guess...
Was it the theater Jackie did his TV show for?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
What I hear they did is put up two of those old Bill Graham posters and renamed it.
Yeah, I can't think of two different icons of show business.
Yeah, really.
Bill Graham and Jackie Gleason.
Yeah, why they just didn't play up the Jackie Gleason aspect, I don't know. But then again, this is South Florida.
Right. Okay.
Welcome to it.
I feel warm.
The Nicole Sandler Show, live Monday through Thursdays at 10 a.m. Eastern, or podcast anytime at radioornot.com.
And I got something to say, my friend.
Searching people, come on, oh no. If you're feeling what I'm feeling, come on.
And welcome back to Filter Free Radio, broadcasting live. I want to mention real quick, right about 30 minutes from now, as soon as this program gets off the air, you want to go to ProgressiveBlendRadio.com, which is also where you can hear this show live every time we broadcast. ProgressiveBlendRadio.com, our good friends, DJ Downtown, and folks at the More Me Show at ProgressiveBlendRadio.com will be doing a fantastic debate, analysis, and coverage program live for you, so check it out. I want to get right to our comment line, and I want to mention really quick as a quick disclaimer that we just got this thing set up yesterday, and we're still working out some technical bugs here and there. So if you're calling and it's ringing and ringing and ringing, just let it ring, and we'll get to your call as soon as we have an open line. So if you call and it rings, that means there we have someone else on the phone that we want to talk to or we're speaking with. But just continue to call, and we'll pick up your call if we're you're calling, and we're going to answer it. So I guess whatever. Scott, you're still here, right? You can hear me, Scott.
I'm fucking with you. I'm still here.
All right, cool. I want to let's go to the comment line because we have our first caller, and this is so cool. Our first caller is Mark Taylor Canfield. Friend of the show and awesome independent activist and journalist and blogger, and has been on the program. Mark, it's good to talk to you, buddy.
Hey, yeah, somebody texted me a message about this new call-in line, so I thought I would try it. Thanks for letting me know about it.
That was
awesome, dude.
That was a little behind the scenes special scoop from me for you, because we want you on the show all the time, Mark. You're an awesome activist and blogger and really active man on the street, you know, and we really appreciate everything you do.
Well, I appreciate you guys. I was loving your discussion earlier, especially that last series of sound clips was pretty amazing, telling it like it is, you know.
Right.
And you don't get an opportunity to hear that very often in the U.S. media. And I have an update, actually, about the federal grand jury in Seattle. There are...
Oh, yeah, what's going on? Can you tell our listeners real quick what that is?
And there's been a federal grand jury investigation going on in Seattle. There were raids on the homes of activists in Portland and Seattle back in July. And at this point, there are three people in jail, Catherine Olgenick, Matt Duran, and Leland Plant. And they've been jailed for civil contempt for refusing to testify at a grand jury. Unfortunately, all of the documents in terms of the warrants and subpoenas in this grand jury are sealed, so nobody really knows what it's about. But the latest is that the Seattle Post-Intelligencer are actually, which is our only real newspaper left, by the way, after Frank Button just gave $75,000 in free ads to a Republican candidate for governor.
Uh-oh.
He's the owner of the Seattle Times, by the way. We'll get to that in a second. But in the Post-Intelligencer was able to report on the fact that some documents had been unsealed on October 16th, and they showed that the FBI was following anarchists from Portland or in Portland long before the May Day events. And so that's one of the clarifications on the story, I guess, is that most of the media most of the corporate media hasn't mentioned it at all and has not been reporting on it, but there have been a couple good articles, in one in Salon, one in Truth Out, and lately one in Al Jazeera, which is why it's breaking internationally, this whole story. They're calling it America's Pussy Riot, so
yeah,
it's finally getting some international attention.
Yeah,
not from U.S. news media, though.
Yeah, and of course,
of course not.
Real truth-telling independent folks like Filter Free Radio covered the Pussy Riot story, like, what, 2 months ago, Scott? So, you know. not that it's, I guess that was a bad way to put that. But yeah, no, it's good that more people are catching on to what the hell is really going on, you know.
Well, that's one of the reasons I appreciate the work you do, Mark.
Excuse me? Sorry, Scott.
Oh, no, I was going to say, that's one of the reasons I appreciate the work you're doing is informing our listeners and us and everybody else about, you know, it's important to communicate, I think, you know, find channels to communicate because we don't, obviously don't have corporate media or mainstream media. And so we had to find our various outlets. And so that's why I always appreciate the work you're doing, Mark, because, you know, you inform us from literally on the ground of protests, you know, there in Seattle and all the Occupy encampments and things of what's going on. And so it's really good news. And I think it gives us hope because there are people out there getting active and you've given us lots of evidence of that. So it's good stuff, man.
Hey, thanks, Guy. What's happening is that I'm doing more and more journalism and less activism because I'm so busy trying to cover what's happening in the world of activism. It's crazy. So we do have an effort ongoing. We are working on a U.S. media working group and an international collaboration with some really good folks. But in terms of like what I've been doing, I've got so many articles in the can and I can't even keep track of them all really because there's so much to cover around the world. And I find myself just always looking for media coverage of very important international events and not finding it in the U.S. media. So I guess I'm back to being sort of a media democracy advocate and just trying to make sure that the people that I work with know this stuff so that it can eventually, you know, get that kind of coverage. But there's been a lot of people, you know, throughout the years from Amy Goodman on down. And actually, we're all sort of working together. You know, I feed them information and make sure that they know what's going on. And we all sort of are trying to work together to break through the corporate media blockade. Because on this particular story, especially, it has been a complete media blackout in the U.S. And so finally, starting to see Al Jazeera, I'm lobbying the Guardian and other folks to get on this. You know, people like Yoko Ono need to get involved, just like they did with Pussy Riot. Yep. It's time, you know, for people to stand up and say, you know, these activists in Seattle and Portland and Olympia, they really shouldn't be left alone having to face this. You know, it's really a major international issue. And of course, it's not the only time that grand juries have been used against activists.
Yeah, right.
And it's not the only activists in jail right now in the United States, including some might say Don Siegelman, former governor of Alabama.
You betcha.
In terms of political prisoners, yeah.
And there's a bunch of petitions you can sign to get Governor Siegelman out. I can't remember what the website is, but go ahead.
DonSiegelman.com.
There you go.
Yes, exactly. And also, if you go to No Political Repression at WordPress, No Political Repression, you'll find updates on what's happening at the federal grand jury. Nobody in the corporate media is really going to keep up on it.
Right.
But there's also that really good article in Al Jazeera, and I think now there's one in Salon and Truth Out. So in at least, you know, it's starting to get some treads, and it's starting to move. So that's a good thing, because Duran has been in jail since August. So that's a really difficult story to cover.
Has it been...
I do.
Where's?
Well, I was just going to say. I do want to mention real quick that there's a bunch of other folks calling in, and I want to get to them. But no, it's okay. I don't want to. I want to be able to wrap up the conversation with Mark, though.
Well, I guess the latest is that's the update from Seattle. Then the other thing I wanted to mention really quick was that there's been a major blow against freedom of the press in the United States, and that is that Seattle Times publisher Frank Blethyn has just given somewhere around $80,000 in free ads to the Republican candidate for governor in Washington State. So it's a huge, major scandal. 100 reporters and staff members of the Seattle Times signed a letter in protest. It's a huge deal. And I think it has a huge significance for the press in the United States. And what I just wrote about was, you know, given the post-United Citizens United decision era of political elections in the United States is basically just a sport for the wealthy. And here's an example where a wealthy newspaper publisher can play William Randolph Hearst. It's like Citizen Kane is back, you know. He's going to push his candidate for governor in Washington State and try to defeat Jay Inslee, our former congressman that's running on the Democratic side. So, huge scandal, another big story that needs to be covered because we as journalists really can't stand by and watch this kind of thing happen. It's just ridiculous. It's just the media is being bought and sold in the United States, and it's so sad. We really need to get back to some sort of real democracy, because anytime you have someone that powerful, by the way, the Post Intelligencer, the Seattle Post Intelligencer is now only online, so the Seattle Times is the only daily newspaper in Seattle. And this guy has given the whole newspaper over to the Republican candidate for governor, which is unheard of. I mean, even Fox News doesn't do that. So.
Yeah, at least not nakedly and openly. Story.
Yeah, just keep an eye on that, because hopefully there will be a huge backlash amongst journalists around the country, because that's just ridiculous. And if you know, it's got to be embarrassing for them that they're the first, you know, major backlash came from their own reporters. I mean, I suggest they go on strike personally. But
there you go.
You know, I'm not a labor leader, so we'll see what happens.
Well,
anyway. Oh. Thanks for the opportunity to throw out those stories, guys, because it's, you know, there's always something going on that the media is not going to cover, and it's great that you guys have an open door for that. I appreciate it very much.
Oh, absolutely, dude. We appreciate you coming on and keeping us informed, man. It's important to spread the word and keep the you know, information out there, because obviously, like you said, we need to be the media, and it speaks to the need to form a third and parallel system to supplement once the mainstream corporate media collapses, and it certainly will under its own weight. We need to be there with our own media to step up and say, oh, look, here we are. We've already got this established, and we are the media, and here's the news you need to know. And so thank you, Mark, for doing the good work. We appreciate it, bud.
Hey, Scott and Jacob, you know, I'd really love to bring you in on this U.S. media working group thing that we're doing. It's just an example of exactly what you just said, just trying to work with everybody we can in the alternative media to create some kind of network where everybody can work together and help update and let each other know what's going on, maybe even create some kind of a news wire or something that we can all use. So
yeah.
I will stay in touch on
that. Oh,
that'd
be awesome, dude.
The independent news wire. I'm all
about it. So.
I'm stoked about it already, dude. No, that's awesome.
That sounds great, dude. Yeah, absolutely.
There's somebody in Oregon with Occupy Oregon, Dean Edwards, who's doing great work on that. And I'll just make sure he gets in touch with you guys, because
yes, please.
You know, we're trying to approach it from a very ethical point of view, in that, you know, we want to reinforce the Society for Professional Journalism standards for journalism that nobody seems to cover in the corporate media anymore, just like Frank Buzzin showed. So I will, you know, I'll get you guys some more information on that. And in the meantime, I guess it's time to go cover the bread and circus of the U.S. presidential
debates. Right, right.
I have to do some fact-checking.
Yeah, bread and circus indeed, bread and circus.
Well said. Appreciate the call, Mark, bud, and we'll talk to you soon, man.
Great. All right, we'll stay in touch. Bye.
All right, that's awesome. And so the comment line apparently is a huge success, Scott. During that 10-minute call there with Mark, we had probably 6 other phone calls.
Wow. No way.
And of course,
that's cool, dude. I love it.
I don't have caller ID on all of them. Of course, it tells me the phone number that people are calling from. But if it's not already logged in to the... did I just lose Scott? Damn it. Hang on. I pushed the wrong button there. And like I said... Scott, are you back? How do we get Scott back on the air? There we go. Scott, are you back? There you are. Scott, talk to me.
I am, but yeah, you're putting
me
on hold.
Okay, sorry about that. Okay, so again, this is a brand new comment line that we just started and activated yesterday. So there is a little bit of technical difficulties that your operator, moi, is figuring out.
Please stand by.
On the fly. We're figuring this out on the fly as I'm doing this, literally. So now if I push all the buttons right, we have someone in the 224 area code calling in. Who are you and where are you calling from? Hello? Oh, come on. Talk to me. 224, you're on the air, if you can hear me. Hello.
What'd you do, man?
I'm pretty sure I have them up. 224?
Maybe they can't hear you.
I don't know.
It sort of looks like it.
I'm going to
pain.
I got to tell you, though, just talking to Mark gives me hope, though, man.
Right.
I mean, he actually said, you know, there's so much activism that I'm doing more media coverage of the activism than I am being an activist. And I think that's great. You know, it's like there's so much, you know, we often talk about solutions, and solutions are activism. You have to be active to have to foster any real solution. And so I think it's great that we have so many options out there to choose from. And it looks like we got another caller on the line there. Is that Adam?
Yeah, I think the caller is Adam, but I think I pushed the wrong button. So, Adam, if you want to call back, that's fine. and I also want to extend the invitation to anyone who can hear my voice at the moment and you'd like to participate in the conversation. 202-69...
We've only got about 10 minutes left in the show here, bud.
79FFR. And I also want to mention that... coming up in 10 minutes, like Scott says, the end of the program, but also the beginning of DJ Downtown and the More Me Show's live debate coverage, again, immediately following this program in 10 minutes, that you want to check out on Progressive.
Is he going to be broadcasting on this channel?
He may be broadcasting on this channel. We were going to be nice and log off a few minutes early for him. So that they can broadcast on this channel, which is where they broadcast the More Me Show, where they normally broadcast when they do the program Sundays at 5 p.m. Eastern, right here on the Ustream channel of RadioOrNot.com. But I know for a fact that it will be on their website, and that is ProgressiveBlendRadio.com, which is also where you can hear this show live every single time we do it. So that's super awesome. And...
is Adam there?
I am. I'm sorry. I wasn't sure if I should say anything.
Hey.
I'm so sorry, but there seems to be something wrong with your system. So thank you for...
Yeah. We're working on it.
I tell you what, I would appreciate, though, but I want to kind of work out the bugs. So can you call that back, Adam?
Yeah, sure. Do you want me to stay on here with you and also call?
No. That's fine, because then there would be a crazy echo. So just call back, and I want to, I don't know why that didn't work. So I apologize.
Yay, technology.
Adam, are you there?
I think I am.
Yeah. Okay. Now we have another caller live on our 202-6979-FFR, and Scott, you can hear me and everyone can hear each other. We're working out the bugs.
I'm having fun. I'm grinning ear to ear like a jackass. So.
Right on. What's on your mind, man? What do you want to bring to the table? We got a few minutes before we need to wrap up.
Well, I mean, I haven't heard much about George McGovern except as political jokes. You know, like in Futurama, you'd have Nixon. Oh, what a McGovern I've been. But he looks like he was a nice guy, a good guy, and the world isn't a lesser place now that he's gone, I think.
Yeah, I think you're spot on, Adam. It's what we were talking about earlier, where it's like, you know, honestly, he's one of the people, it's hard to believe that this was a Democratic presidential candidate, and yet you've never heard about him in the last 20 years or so, because he's not out there stumping for the Bill Clintons and Barack Obamas, et cetera. He was just out of the public life. And moreover, not part of the machine. You know, he was really an anti-establishment kind of guy. It's amazing that this guy made it all the way to being our presidential candidate at one point.
Phones are ringing off the hook, literally, at this joint, so I'm not going to lie. Sorry to cut in, though. Oh, go ahead.
That's all right. Fun with new technology, right?
Right.
You have to tell me how you're doing this later, Jacob.
Yeah, magic. Magic. And it's...
He has no idea.
No. I really want to mention, and I'm happy you give me the opportunity to do this, Adam, that this is something we just set up yesterday, and you can call in live to the program and speak with us live during the broadcast at the same number, or anytime we're not live, we would still love for you to call and leave a message that we can play on the air. And this is basically a call to our podcasters. The reason I wanted to set it up this way is we get a ton of podcast views, and folks who want to, or folks watch this program on the internet as a recorded podcast, not necessarily live. And
for those folks, I want to be able to include everyone in the conversation who wants to participate. So we have a live call-in number and a voicemail. It's the same number. It's not toll-free. There's your disclaimer. But if you have long distance or whatever, definitely give us a call. Or if you're in the D.C. area, it's a local number, 202.
And we're listening.
And we're listening, and you're live on the air, 202-6979-FFR. Now, that was about the best number I could get, and I liked it because it's got 69 and FFR, and it's a D.C. number, and the price was right, so...
Right. You got the logo.
Well, like I said... I'm glad I could be your guinea pig. It looks like, you know, you're on your way to fixing these problems.
Yeah, but, it's simply it's when someone calls in, I have an array of buttons to pick from, and if I click the wrong button, that hangs up on Scott and then takes whoever's calling in on live, and then it will switch. And it's like, it's weird. So I'm playing with it.
Right. Well, before you cut me loose, because I know we're at the top of the show or bottom of the show, whatever the technical term is, have you been keeping an eye on this Walmart union story?
You know, I'm happy you called in about that. I want you to riff on that for a couple minutes, because I know that we've talked about that in the past, having you on to talk about that. And I would still like to do that in the future and do a bit about that.
Yeah, well, that's why I bring it up. I was like, this would be a pretty good time to do that proposed Walmart special, because, I mean, I did 4.5 years hard time at Walmart, and you know, I mean, my conditions weren't anywhere near as bad as what you're, you know, I wasn't living in a tent, I was living at mom's. But you know, like, I'm 31 and I have knee and back trouble, you know, probably from, you know, pulling too many pallets at a time or pushing too many carts at a time. I've lived it, and you know, don't get me wrong, the people are okay, but Walmart is rotting from the inside out.
Yeah, they'll do that.
You know.
Yeah, they'll do
and,
that.
And, you know, I heard, I guess someone was living in a tent outside during winter. You know, there's just no... Will they do anything to make a dollar? I mean, will the Waltons do anything? Is there nothing that, you know, say, I'm not comfortable with this. We'll pass on that extra penny. You know.
You know, the interesting thing, too, is that Sam Walton's probably rolling over in his grave. I mean, here's a guy who founded his legacy on Made in America was their slogan. And I can remember the commercials of Made in America.
Yep.
I mean, despite what they were doing to their employees. But now it's all, everything's, you know, it's cheap shit from China, and they're paying slave wages, and everyone's on Medicaid. And it's really an abysmal, because here's the Walton heirs are the four of the top 10 richest people in the country. So I'm pretty sure the four Waltoners were included in that list of 10 people who made $50 billion last year.
Yep.
Enough to feed all the world's hungry. So these people are clearly.
I've heard.
I'm sorry to cut it off short, but we do need to wrap up real quick, because the folks.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Adam. I appreciate the call, bud, and we'll do the.
Thanks for having me.
Okay, man, and we'll do the thing. We'll do it soon, bud. Okay, I appreciate the phone call, and thanks to Mark Taylor Canfield and for calling in. All the other folks who tried to call in, hey, call next time. And big news: we're going to start broadcasting live Monday nights and Wednesday nights. So if you like or want more filter-free radio, booyah! We just fixed that one for you, Scott. Man, real quick, 10 seconds, final thoughts. What you want to share, real quick?
It's just the soulless nature and the caricatures. I want to read a real quick Hunter S. Thompson quote about Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon, quote, was a foul caricature of himself, a man with no soul and no inner convictions. Does that sound like anybody else we know?
Booyah. I also want to mention real quick, as I do at the end of every program, I want to give a huge thank you and shout out to all of the folks who helped make this program possible. Of course, the folks who lend their stations and syndicate this program, Nicole Sandler at RadioOrNot.com and DJ Downtown of the More Me Show at ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. Go to ProgressiveBlendRadio.com right now, and they are about to start the live debate coverage. And we will see you next time Beginning next week, we will broadcast live on Monday night and Wednesday night, same time, 7 to 9 Eastern, 4 to 6 Pacific. Hope you check out our website, filterfreeradio.com, and keep up the good work and activism and all that jazz. And let's get ready right now for the debate, which is about to happen. So progressiveblendradio.com, go check it out, and we'll see you next week.
This is it.
There's a time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart, that you can't take part. You can't even passively take part. And you've got to put your bodies upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, upon all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop.
So give me something to believe. 'Cause I am living just to breathe. And I need something more to keep on breathing for. So give me something to believe.
You're listening to Jacob Dean, streaming live on the web.
The revolution will be broadcast.
We bring you the real stuff.